evening. She laid in bed with me at bedtime, said goodnight, Mama, and went to her room. That was about 9 o'clock. I woke up the next morning. I kind of usually savor my weekend mornings, wake up quiet, have coffee, and then start to cook breakfast. And at about 11, I realized I hadn't heard any noise. And I had cooked an omelet, and I went to go get her, and she was gone.
And let's be clear.
Correct. I did oddly wake up around 1 o'clock in the morning, and now in hindsight, I'm thinking that maybe I had heard something and it didn't register all the way, because I don't normally wake up at 1 o'clock in the morning. But that's just guessing at this point.
What did you
just woke up. I don't remember hearing anything distinct, but now in hindsight, like thinking back, maybe I did hear something and it just didn't register all the way because I was asleep. I don't know. She left a note and she took clothes with her. And her note doesn't really fit like the typical runaway note. It was, I love you very much, including all of her family and siblings, and that she didn't want to hurt us, and she was just gone.
The note, you believe, though, was written. That is her writing. That's her penmanship.
It was her writing. It was uncharacteristically neat for her writing, but it was her writing. I think someone convinced her that this was a good idea. I don't think that this was her idea.
You said she...
Stuff that I don't believe she just, like, walked out and got on a bus or just started walking down the street. She took one of my larger, like, Osprey backpacking bags, and her blow dryer, her flat iron, so things that you would take if you were thinking you were going somewhere.
Be clear, she's never done anything like this before.
Enough stuff that I don't believe she just like walked out and got on a bus or just started walking down the street. She took one of my larger like Osprey backpacking bags, and her blow dryer, her flat iron, the things that you would take if you were thinking you were going somewhere.
To be clear.
No, she had done, like, she had skipped school, she always came home, like, nothing where she left. We have a close relationship, and she's close with her family, friends. She doesn't, she's really involved with her siblings, it just doesn't make sense that she would not have any contact with anyone. If anything, maybe she was a little clingy and nicer, but I don't think that was really a thing. I don't really see anything. We there was no fights, like I said. She's a 14-year-old girl, and I'm her mother, so there's times where you have the normal teen issues. Overall, we got along well. We spent a lot of time together. She likes to do things with me. We joke around. We have a good relationship. So, in hindsight, I immediately, once she was missing, went to her friend's house and talked to the friend and the friend's parents. They started helping me reach out to other friends and other parents and looking for her. And immediately, all the children started saying that she had been talking to a man online. As more and more time went by, more and more kids came forward with information about this friend that she had online, who was a man in his 30s. And I really don't have all that much more information. We have conflicting information. It's coming from teens. And I don't know if part of that was intentional, but there's a lot of conflicting information. One, they thought that he was from Connecticut, another Arizona, another Louisiana. We've had kids since come forward anonymously with even more information. There's some confusion and conflict between someone else that the kids have been associating with online. So there's a lot of, there's nothing straightforward.
Right.
Had not liked what was going on with Ella, she would have been sneaking behind my back with like internet stuff like that. had Apple parental controls on the phone. She somehow was able to still download Text Now onto it. I don't have any idea how she did it. I was able to find it in her settings, but couldn't see the app in the apps or the app list. The only way I was able to access it was to undo all my parental settings. So I'm not sure how she achieved that. She had no app store. She had no Safari on it. I had locked those down to the parental controls. And then she had a school computer. And unfortunately, the school computer was kind of a loose cannon. In December, I had gone to the school and the principal and asked them to lock down an entire page full of lists of possible apps that I wouldn't want her to access, which they helped facilitate. And I had been, I didn't know what was going on. I did not know the extent of it, but I was alarmed with things enough that I was trying to lock everything down even tighter. Was bringing her to work with me, just trying to keep like a real close eye on all of the internet stuff. I've repeatedly talked with her about the dangers of social media and strangers, and you know, when they're little, you start with stranger danger. As they get older, you start talking about the internet, and that's always been a constant presence. You hear about the kids that get taken from grocery stores or all of that. We've had
now we talking about your daughter.
Started coming forward with all, again, this is all subjective and from teenager. So her closest friend said she thought she had originally met him on Omegle. Come to find out, Omegle was shut down in like November of last year. My understanding now, I didn't know anything about this prior to her disappearing, is that it was like a roulette. It matches you with random people. And then once you match with someone, you go on to another platform. So you typically will use like Telegram, Discord, or Text Now to communicate. I had found the Text Now and then wiped her phone because I didn't want her to have access to it. And with the parental controls already being set up and having been bypassed, I did do that, which I'm now kicking myself for because by wiping, factory resetting her phone, it has limited what I've been able to access and get back into to try to figure out more. The police did come, like I think about 11 days ago now, and finally take her phone and her computer, and they're trying to figure out the digital footprint and backtrack. So I'm hoping that will lead us to more information. There was two separate children that are not associated, do not know each other at all, that saw Ella on a video with a man in his 30s, white man, dark hair, giving similar descriptions. We've had a couple witness tips that also have similar descriptions, but at that point, I don't know if our flyers and information we have been putting out has helped form some of those opinions. Unfortunately, none of the sightings have been substantiated. The camera's not working, or it was too dark, or we get tips from all over. It's really confusing. I don't really have a clear path of or area. We had a lot of sightings in Everett about a week and a half, almost 2 weeks ago now. They've kind of slowed down. We're not seeing a lot. We had an email this morning, possibly, I believe, somewhere in like Northern California. It was very vague, so I don't know how much validity I would put to that. People are looking, though, and my first objective was to try to get as many eyes out there helping us look, because we only have so many eyes, and we're doing our best, but we're limited. So my first plan of attack was getting flyers to store employees, because then we have surveillance at those stores for the hours that they're open. We've now had people helping printing out flyers and getting them onto the streets. I spent the first few days going to all the neighbors, trying to get to see if anybody's Ring cameras or anything picked up footage. I have a hard time believing there isn't a camera somewhere that has her on it.
You told me.
She was treated as a runaway initially. I think primarily, you know, he had the note, she took stuff, she left willingly. I was definitely frustrated with that at first. My gut immediately was something is really wrong. Within 48 hours, I had reached out to her whole network of friends, and they all gave the same concerns and story about a man she was talking to online. As more and more time went past, I've just gained more, I don't want to say confidence. It's more and more obvious that she isn't sleeping on her friend's couch. She isn't doing the typical runaway scenario. Friends was kicked out of his house and is doing the runaway homeless kid scenario. He's still going to school, going to dentist appointments, and he's been trucking around on buses and trying to help track Ella down and communicating with me. All of her friends have been communicating with me regularly and trying to find any information that they can. I'm hoping at this point that a lot of it's just behind the scenes and I don't know what's going on. I was frustrated by the lack of immediate response, that those first few, you know, days are so critical to finding someone in a nefarious situation, which I believe she's in. My gut from day one was something's really wrong, and it was frustrating to have it treated like a typical runaway. Our tips, they have tried to pull buses over, they have gotten warning screens across public transport, they've gone into several apartment buildings based on tips that she might be in apartments. They are following through with the tips. I just feel at this point, there's no substantiated proof, is essentially what they are telling us. There's no proof of a crime. To me, a 14-year-old vanishing with no clues and no sightings is a proof enough of a crime.